Penguin Random House Audio presents Beauty in the Broken Places, a memoir of love, faith, and resilience. This is the author, Allison Pataki, with a foreword written and read by Lee Woodruff, and epilogue written and read by David Levy. For Louisa and Nelson, our lantern bearers on this journey, and for Lily, the light that pulled us forward. We shall not cease from exploration, and the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and know the place for the first time. T.S. Eliot. The world breaks everyone, and afterward many are strong at the broken places. Ernest Hemingway.
Foreword. Lee Woodruff. For better or worse. Such a simple phrase that most of us don't truly contemplate as we stand at the altar, giddy with love, and surrounded by family and friends. Why would we ever choose to play out the worst-case scenario in our heads? As Allison Pataki and her husband David Levy buckled their seatbelts on a flight to Hawaii, excited for their baby moon, the last thing they could have imagined was that in a few short hours, their plane would make an emergency landing in Fargo, North Dakota. Dave, an outgoing athletic 30-year-old, would suffer a rare, life-threatening stroke. The Levys would never make it to their destination. Life had just dealt them a cruel and unexpected blow. Instead of celebrating the last vestiges of coupledom before parenthood rearranged their lives, Allison would be sitting in a hospital room, 5 months pregnant, holding one of her husband's cold, empty shoes while he fought to survive. A friend once remarked that life's complications do not end at the altar, but for many of us, it is where they begin. While that may sound somewhat macabre from my older road-tested perch, it speaks to all of the things we cannot know as we stand wide-eyed and innocent, pledging to entwine our life with another's. In those moments, we feel the unbridled anticipation of possibility, the choices to be made, the thrill of life's blank page waiting to be colored in together. But there are other surprises in store, both sorrowful and beautiful. Life never moves in a straight line, constantly reminding us that we don't get to write the script. Therein lies the beauty, even in the moments when we feel uncertain, afraid, and broken. I'm 20-plus years older than Allison, and we first met as I exited a restroom stall at ABC News. True story. I felt an instant connection. She has a personality that you want to bottle for a gray day, crackling with energy, naturally upbeat and bright, intelligent and empathetic. As our friendship grew, we discovered many connection points, from her younger years in Albany, I'm an Albany girl too, to our summers spent in the Adirondacks. She had visited our tiny lakeside community. We were both writers, and she'd worked at ABC News, where my husband Bob Woodruff is a reporter. After that initial meeting, Allison left the news business and published her first novel. We became email friends, occasionally chatted on the phone, complained when the writing wasn't coming. I complained. She kept writing. I have the most wonderful picture of Allison, Bob, and me at her book launch for The Accidental Empress. She's resplendent in a gorgeous dress and, unbeknownst to us at the time, newly pregnant. I proudly thought of Allie and Dave as younger versions of me and Bob, devoted to each other, adventuresome, and supportive of one another's careers. They were in it for the long haul. Allie and I shared a love of words and writing, and yet we were social animals too. We got oxygen from spending time with friends. Each of us had always been fiercely independent, which worked well with the demanding and often unexpected hours of our husbands' chosen careers. Also, like we had been, they were determined to have a family. I was thrilled to hear about Allie's pregnancy, excited to watch such a couple experience one of life's truest gifts. So it was with shock and disbelief that I opened an email from Allison explaining that Dave had had a stroke and they were at a rehabilitation hospital in Chicago. It was devastating to think about anyone I knew setting out on this horrible journey. This was not a curse I would wish on my enemy, let alone a young couple on the cusp of becoming parents. It seems so unfair. Both of us twinned in this horrible fate. Husbands cut down in their prime. Dave before he had finished his residency. Bob before he could truly enjoy the privileged anchor chair. Meeting that day, by the sink, years earlier, when I was just transitioning out of my caregiving role after my life was upended by Bob's injury, neither Allison nor I could have predicted that she would join my club, the one I refer to as the Club of the Bad Thing, a club in which no one wants to be a member. I ached for them both. Knowing too much about this injury, I worried how Dave would recover and what life would look like for them. Would their child ever know her father? When our own tragedy struck, Bob and I had 18 years of marriage under our belt, 4 children, and a strong foundation that had already weathered disappointment and loss. I could not stop thinking about the next stage of their journey. I knew the statistics. My husband was that rare miracle in the world of TBI, traumatic brain injury, recovery. Even with such amazing progress and success, our own relationship had been strained at the seams, rearranged at times, and frayed by the roller coaster ride of recovery that Allie describes so well. TBI is one of the very worst tragedies that can befall a loved one. Yes, of course, there is death and cancer, dementia and ALS, an entire roster of other horrible clubs that loved ones inadvertently join. It's the in an instant nature of a brain injury, the alacrity with which it permanently changes and upends lives, relationships, and marriages that is so stunning. The immediate line between before and after creates a sense of emotional whiplash. Like Allison, I was reeling for weeks and months, simply trying to process the fact that my husband had been hit by a roadside bomb. I knew the risks of being married to a war correspondent, but there is an ocean's distance between possibility and reality. In 2003, when Bob was embedded with the Marines during the Iraq invasion, and for the entire decade he reported from war zones, I had contemplated death, but never disability. Not at his age. Not in the prime of our lives. Silly me. 3 years later, as unopened bottles of champagne sat on the dining room table, sent by friends and colleagues to celebrate Bob's ABC World News Tonight co-anchor appointment, my husband lay in a medically induced coma, toggling between life and death. One day he had kissed me goodbye for what was meant to be a short trip to the Middle East. Days later, I was being told he might not make it out of surgery, even as plans were underway to airlift him home from Baghdad. Like Allison, I would struggle to comprehend the fact that our world had been so swiftly and completely shattered. Why is TBI so devastating? When the injured person is your husband, there is a special element of heartbreak, an unusual tangle of emotions, sorrow, and gratitude, and so much damned uncertainty. There are no percentages to shoot for, no norms, no one can tell you exactly how much your loved one will recover or how much of him will return. In that first year, lying beside my sleeping husband, I understood that it was possible to feel completely alone, right next to the person you loved most. He was there, but not there. Physically present, but with pieces missing. It was as if he were an engine, and someone had reached inside and fiddled with the wiring. Gone was what had made Dave, Dave, Allison writes so compellingly in these pages. The loved one grieves for the intangibles, the inchoate part of coupledom that is as hard to define as a great sense of humor, an ear for good music, or that silly thing in the movie that you saw that weekend when you were first dating. Those shared experiences are what sticks a couple together, the gooey center between two halves of the Oreo. But above all, there is grief. So much complicated, guilty, unarticulated grief over being thrust in this new, unwanted direction. And because your husband is alive, because he survived, you do not have permission for this most simple of human behaviors, the space to mourn the loss of your dreams and to honor the brokenness inside. You cannot speak of this. It would be too selfish. You got him back. Isn't that enough? Aren't you lucky? That ripping, tearing sensation that only you can feel? That crack inside your ribcage? That is the sound of your heart breaking. This may seem hard to comprehend, but there were times when I wondered if it might have been better if Bob had died on the battlefield. Grieving a dead husband would take you to the very lowest place, and then you had no choice but to get back up and take a step forward. What if Bob never recovered, I wondered? What if he remained in a childlike state? What
happened? We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.